E.F. Schumacher was a famous economist and a protege to a famous economist of the West in the 20th century, John Maynard Keynes. E.F. Schumacher. I would highly recommend you to read his book, whichever field you are from, whichever area you are from, just out of intellectual interest. E.F. Schumacher. Small is Beautiful, his book. Small is Beautiful, that's the title of the book. He says the task of education would be, first and foremost, the transmission of ideas and value, what to do with our lives. At present, there can be little doubt that the whole of mankind is in mortal danger, not because we are short of scientific and technological know-how, we are for that. We have the best technologies, we are in the best technological stage up to now, of course. But we will be in mortal danger. Why? Because we tend to use these things destructively, without wisdom, without hikmah, with no virtues, guiding. Therefore, more education can only help us if it produces more wisdom. So I think we're heading somewhere, right? So what would be, this is the exciting part. And I've formulated this, taking into account all of the faculties and courses that is here in UNITAR. What would be the practical implication of the earlier discussions? Right? When we're clear what the problem is, when we're clear what is the conception of man that we affirm, what is the meaning of virtues and happiness, what is the practical implication? Apa akan kesan dia atau apa hasil dia apabila kita faham konsep-konsep itu sebegitu rupa? What would be the implication? First, to education, present-day education. Education must therefore refer to this reality of man, the deeper reality of man that is with the soul, not only to the physical aspect. It involves melipatkan penyemaian virtues, cultivation of virtues. Therefore, by definition, in education, an educated person means his intellect and character is cultivated, immanent beradab. A clever person, a person who scores straight A's, may not necessarily be educated as a result of that. What is the example of adab towards knowledge? There is some kind of priorities, you put things in the proper place. What is more important? You cannot level everything as if it's the same. There is a place for everything. So priorities in terms of knowledge. That's why for Muslims they stress this fardu ain fardu kifayah. And there's different emphasis on assessments, and UNITAR is positive. I'm happy to know, encouraged to know that they are really trying to change this or trying to improve the assessments process. That's part of the workshops. And it should take into consideration the insights and wisdom of these past luminaries. They have a lot more, a lot of these things they are still relevant. Even more for Muslims, it's still relevant. These people are not really dead. Their ideas are still alive, are still impacting millions and hundreds of people for generations. The writings of these people have resulted in prosperous civilizations. But now, because of a great challenge, these things have been put aside, not pragmatic, not profitable. Some examples of some institutes and people who are still trying to bring back this kind of education. This is in England, Schumacher College. And this college is based on that book I mentioned earlier. ISTAC, International Institute of Islamic Thought and Civilization. Guess where? Okay, siapa tahu ni kat mana? Selain mana orang yang nak tahu? Guess, S, where is that place? Tentu dah pernah nampak? Jalan Duta Kuala Lumpur. This place. Encik Wan wanted to study here. Of course, it's he doesn't need to study And this place is based on a book, based on a concept, based on a certain philosophy. And he has produced great graduates. One of the graduates became a special advisor to the president of Turkey, Erdogan. And there are many more of the graduates here from Asia that you might not have heard of, but they are doing some positive impact to society. Implication to economics and business. We need to rethink this notion of business. A lot of work here, people. There's an adab to business also. There's a, you know, you should. And I teach this in the social entrepreneurship course. You should not only think about profit, but now they are talking about not only about the bottom line, but they're talking about triple bottom line. Meaning the profit. How does the enterprise or business contribute to the well-being of people and the planet? Businesses should talk about or try to understand this notion of human governance, written by our present chairman, former chairman, Professor Julian Prabhakar. Because corporate governance on its own is not sufficient. Look at Volkswagen. Volkswagen, world famous corporate organization. German lady. But recently they had a massive scandal. It was found out they cheated millions of people just to make more profit. But yet they have corporate governance, they have code of ethics, all of this. Therefore, we need to rethink all these things, and we need to use this the earlier discussion about virtue, happiness, man as the foundation for all of our civilizational or public enterprises, affairs. Otherwise, there will be a lot of chaos. So we need to recover a lot of the wisdom from the past. And Schumacher is what we did. This is the source that I already mentioned. And there's a lot of movements in the West who are heading towards this direction already. I'm not just theorizing, but it's already happening on the ground in the West. There's counter-economics movement, rethinking economics movement. They're trying to find a better alternative and solution to how they have been doing business and economics. It's possible, it's doable. In architecture, design architecture, there's an adab to it also. It should be in harmony with nature and man. So that such that when you walk into the building, you feel at peace. You feel in tune with your soul. And there must be some element of beauty, it must be sustainable, of course. This picture, this is a place designed by Dr. Sami Anghawi from Saudi Arabia. This is his house, actually. And this is his vision of what Mecca should be. You know Mecca? Mecca is the center of pilgrimage for the Muslims. And as a result of over the years they have been expanding this place, more glass and steel, more to expand, people are coming. But at a cost, at a price, they destroy a lot of the natural environment. They destroy many things. Of course, people can debate about that, pros and cons. But he said, this Dr. Sami Anghawi said, if you give me a chance, I will change Mecca, not like how it is today. And he can only do this if he understands what it means to be human. What is happiness, what is virtues, all these things. Beautiful. Right? And this is very Quranic too. Relevant sources if you're interested. What about to culinary and food? I wish Dr. Naim is here. Oh gosh. There's a lot of interesting developments and movements in the West. With regards to food, they're trying to change how the food industry works. There's an adab to it, of course. It has to be good, clean, and fair. This notion of tayyib is not just referring to halal, it's more comprehensive. It has to be good, clean, and fair. This good, clean, and fair is coming from the slow food movement. Westerners themselves, I think. There's a whole movement. Instead of fast food, slow. Slow it down. And this kind of thing is more in tune with the fitrah, with human souls, with good character. It's more in tune. and they're talking about transition towards a more sustainable food system. You see, the possibilities are endless. To tourism, because we have a faculty of hospitality or something, yes, the department. There's also another way, as opposed to mass tourism, ramai-ramai pergi sana, because it's fun. You know, you should be more conscious about these things. You know, you should be more careful with your movement. You know, we fly, you know. That's why sometimes I'm hesitant to fly. You actually, you know, you're destroying the environment a bit. But like recently, when we went to Yogyakarta, me and my mother, we noticed these things are still preserved. You know, the local tradition, cultural knowledge. And there's, you know, so there's an implication. And this is from the West again. What about towards work? We should, as a result of this, we should have a different understanding towards work. And this is what I try to inculcate to my students. You know, I think this way of thinking that I need to make a million by the age of 40 should stop. That kind of thinking is destructive, not only to yourself but to others. I want to make a million at any, you know, I don't care, at any cost. Why not you think like this? I work because I want to utilize and develop my faculties. I work because I want to overcome my ego. I work because I want to bring good goods and services that is needed for all human beings for a decent existence. E.F. Schumacher. He has another book called Good Work. Very Islamic, actually. Many other books connected or related or relevant to what should we think about this notion of work. Good Work, another book called Good Work. That was the one just now. Reinvention of Work. They're talking about new economy as a result of this line of thinking. Proposed definition for wholesome graduate. Wow, I can't make time this time. So meaning, since wholesome, his whole being is educated. His mind, body and soul. He knows his place. Because there's a place for everything. Place yourself in relation to your parents, in relation to the elders, in relation to other nations, in relation to other religions, right? You know your place. It's just for himself and others. He knows he has a clear purpose in life, which is to do good. He's not only a good citizen, but more fundamentally, he strives to be a good human being. Now, the underlying philosophy of modern education system for the past 100 years has been to produce a good citizen, to serve the states. And now it's to serve the corporations. So that's why it's very powerful for UNITA to shift that mission from marketable graduates to wholesome graduates. You don't realize that how powerful that is. To me, wow, running here. That's powerful. But how powerful it will be depends on the commitment of the actors, stakeholders, actors rather, within the university. Depends, okay? If all of us understand wholesome in a restricted manner, maka tak ada dia hasilnya. If we understand wholesome in a restricted manner, therefore we won't produce the kind of graduates that we think that we can produce. Strategies and action plan. Of course, we cannot force people, insist people. I cannot force Dr. Dola to come here. He came here from the court. So there are strategies or action plan that perhaps whoever among us who are convinced to do something about it. But I could be not quite accurate. First, I would suggest introduce some kind of core curriculum. But I know this is very difficult, very tedious, FUA and all these things. But I know a lot of universities, they are still doing this. Harvard is still doing this. Because they, you know, that's why they talk about liberal arts. So the first year, they have some kind of core curriculum that focuses on the humanities, not only on ethics. History is important because history, if you know about the history of great people, great leaders in the past, virtuous leaders, you yourself will be inspired. And princes, I think in the Malay world, they were taught through history, part of their education. Mastery of languages. This is one possible strategy. Second strategy, embed it in all programs. This takes a lot of work. A lot of work. But you know what I mean, right? So meaning, there should be some component of ethics or this kind of thinking in almost all courses. It takes time, because lecturers need to digest, need to contemplate about that. Very much it takes time. This is, I think, is most strategic and perhaps feasible. We create alliances with like-minded individuals, movements, and institutions. The example I gave you today, why don't we create alliances? So, befriend them, get to know them. Because a lot of these movements, and now there's even an alternative Nobel Prize, Right Livelihood Award. Because these people, I think they're from Sweden too, they disagree with the criteria that is used by Nobel Prize to award their prizes. So I can imagine one day we completely embrace this, a meet-up lecturer or student can be a winner of the Right Livelihood Award. Some of their websites of these so-called movements in the West that is more aligned with these Folsom graduates that we have in mind. Another strategy which we have kind of proposed with top nation is perhaps we should organize some kind of conference or symposium or colloquium where we display our interest on the subject matter. So this is like a strong statement, lah. Macam you berniat, berjanji, berniat. You make a commitment that you want to head to this direction. Okay, so this is where you can gather like-minded scholars, intellectuals, etc. to discuss about these things. And then gradually, when people are part of this, they listen, they will be more won over and they would want to really do something about it. Because like I said, you cannot impose these things. And I know what will happen if you impose. I've seen it myself. Conclusion. The guidance for our future, for our intellectual, educational, economic, political future must be sought from our own sources as well, not only from the Western sources. Because we are not, when we started with that remark with my professor Lattas about Western civilization, that does not mean you have to be anti-West. I'm wearing Western clothes. But we should be more discerned. We should be more selective or critical. But how to do that? You need some kind of training. You must have some kind of knowledge. What's good, what's bad, what is beneficial, what is harmful for our culture, for our civilization, for our people. Just a recap, a wholesome person, therefore, his whole being is educated. He's a man of other, good man. And Emita can be the first university in Southeast Asia or Asia to undertake this path. And truly embody the tagline. I love this tagline. My professors love this tagline. Wisdom from the past inspires the future. I end with this quote, again from Alatas. Since Malaysia is Asian and embraces within its geographical, cultural, and social fold all the great religions which sprang from Asia, all these religions, it is imperative that guidance for our future must be sought from our own sources, what I said earlier. Not all the values of Western culture are desirable, but in order to be able to distinguish this from ones that are desirable, it is necessary that our educational system to be geared to study in depth the histories and thoughts of the peoples of Asia and those of the West. Banyak kerja lah, but guess what? The knowledge of this only can one begin to exercise one's rational choice as to what is good and bad for one's own life. 1970, just 1 year after the 1969 incident. I think I'll end there. Thank you.